called a morning worship service. So here at St. Thomas and St. Nicholas's, we have a couple of services, so it's different strokes for different folks. And this is where we come together and we celebrate and we expect to praise our Lord and we expect to kind of feel the Holy Spirit amongst us. So I want to welcome you all and I want you to feel an atmosphere of expectation, because we're going to have a wonderful time together this morning, and we're really blessed that we're all here together. So let us come together and invite Jesus with the Holy Spirit into our service. So I'm going to say, we're all going to say the yellow words, which is Father God, and then I'm going to say the white words, okay? So together we say, Father God, thank you for this chance to worship you.
Father God,
we come to you with an expectation to be filled by your Spirit. That was quick. I'm going to continue, because there's a couple more bits and bobs. It says, Father God, we pray that you will be blessed by our worship this morning. Father God, renew our hearts and help us to long for holy things unseen. And Father God, pour out your Spirit on us today. So we've got a song coming up.
It's a kind of a song.
Yeah, well, it's a very exciting song. And then we're going to have our thanksgivings. So, yes,
we'd like to get on with it. Be outstanding. Those of you who are able. And I need you to start at a steady march pace. Right. We're going to do an army-style sing and response. This is like an army fitness run. I think this is probably about quick enough for most of you. Are you ready? In the first book of Timothy.
In the first book of Timothy.
That was poor. In the first book of Timothy.
In the first book of Timothy.
Chapter 4, verse 7.
Chapter 4, verse 7.
Says keep yourself in training.
Says keep yourself in training.
For a godly life.
For a godly life.
In the first book of Timothy.
In the first book of Timothy.
Chapter 4, verse 7.
Chapter 4, verse 7.
Says keep yourself in training.
Says keep yourself in training.
For a godly life. Some of you are flagging. Come on, keep going. In the first book of Timothy.
In the first book of Timothy.
Chapter 4, verse 7.
Chapter 4, verse 7.
Says keep yourself in training.
Says keep yourself in training.
For a godly life.
For a godly life.
Okay, James, you ready? In the first book of Timothy.
In the first book of Timothy. So I'm going to read the words in white and you're going to collectively come in the words in yellow. God, our Creator, we thank you for the wonder of new life and for the mystery of human love. We thank you for all whose support and skills surround and sustain the beginning of life. We thank you that we are known to you by name and loved by you from all eternity. We thank you for Jesus Christ, who has opened to us the way of life. We praise you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Okay, so this is specifically for the parents of Max and Adelaide. God has gifted you with Adelaide and Max. What is your response? And together we say, God our Creator, we thank you for the gift of Adelaide and Max entrusted to our care. May we be patient and ready to guide and forgive, so that through our love, Adelaide and Max may come to know your love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Okay, and this is me. May God the Father of all bless these parents and give them grace to love and care for their children. May God give them wisdom, patience and faith. Help them to provide for the children's needs and by their example, reveal the love and truth that are in Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, and this is for all of us to do. So I'm going to...
This is a bit strange if you're not used to our church here, so please excuse me for a moment. Today is Trinity Sunday, which we remember God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we believe that Holy Spirit gives us little nudges, encouragements in our life here. And just as we were sitting there, I was looking at the next slide to come up, and it says, the people of God pray for Adelaide and Max. And I thought, if you're okay, would it be really good to be big praising right here and now? Do you want to come out?
Yeah.
The parents and the children want to come out for a moment. Sorry about this. I sort of know you, and I sort of know you're cool with it. But maybe we can have some people from the congregation. Maybe Wendy is coming in your hand. Where's Wendy? Wendy's one of our people here who helps us with this. Wendy, would you mind laying a hand on Max for me? And you lay a hand on Adelaide. And let's just pray for them. Just pray for them. If you pray out loud, feel free to pray out loud. If you don't pray out loud, God can still hear you. Pray inside, okay? So I'll start and I'll finish, but let's pray. Father, as we pray for these youngsters now, would you send your Holy Spirit upon us? Give us words and pictures and prayers for them.
And Lord, we thank you so much for the gift of children that bring so much to families. We particularly pray this morning for Adelaide and Max, Lord, that you would fill them with your Holy Spirit and bless their parents too, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Father, I'm reminded when we said our thanks to you, thank you for all the love and support that have got the children to this point. And I want to thank you because these mothers gave birth to these children in a really, really stressful time. And I know that you were there with them. And I thank you for the support and the care that they were given in whatever manner that took, Lord. Because we're so grateful that these children are here with us today. Amen.
We thank you, Father, for these wonderful parents of Adelaide and Max, and we ask that you would grant them wisdom in the years to come in all the decisions that they will have to make concerning their children. Thank you, Lord, that you will never leave them and you will never forsake them.
Amen.
Amen.
And all God's people said, Amen. And I was just, sometimes I get just words go through my head when we pray. It's not normally the cheese from the night before, it normally is the Holy Spirit. And I just wanted to encourage you that there'll be times when you don't know what to do next. And I just felt God say to me at the time, just know He's with you. And actually, wherever you are in life, if you've not been in the church for years, you can still turn to Him and say, Help. That's all. So, thank you very much. Wait, sorry, Fleur.
No?
I hand it back to you.
Thank you very much. Right, let's all, while you're here, we're going to send this last final thing. This is a wonderful gift that we have to the church. It's actually by praying for you, we have a commitment to continue to thank God for these children and to continue to support them. So this is our church body. So all we're going to say I was able to get some wine, as Jesus took children in his arms and blessed them. So now we ask God's blessing on Adelaide and Max. Collectively, we thank God for them and welcome them into his church. Okay, thank you. So stay there. This is it now. You're here for at least 45 minutes. okay, so we've got the giving of the gospel. So this is a really, really special gift. And this is a book of...
I got it.
So this is the book of Mark. And this one is for Adelaide. And this is for Max. And the wonderful thing about the Gospels is they tell a story about Jesus' life. And they're actually really quite short and succinct. So you look at the Bible and you think, gosh, that's quite hard. But actually, these are really nice little pocket books to take with them. So this book contains the good news of God's love. Read it, for it tells how you and your family can share eternal life through repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. Welcome to the church! There is one Lord, one faith. Together we welcome you to the fellowship of faith. We are children of the same Heavenly Father. We welcome you.
Give him a round.
So, we have a Sunday school, which is going to go now. So, can we have... Yes? Yes. Goes out the back. So, Rosalind, all the children... Oh, Liv and Hattie's here. Bo, yeah. So, Ivy and William, you are more than welcome to go.
Do you want to go with Bo?
Sure.
You can always come back if you want to. You don't have to stay out with us.
You guys can more than welcome to go and sit down. We're going to pray for the children and pray that they have a nice time in Sunday school. Children, I'm going to ask Colin, because he looked in my eyes, that's your own fault, Colin.
Thank you.
Grace's first time reading, so I'm very proud of Mummy right now.
Jesus. Jesus calls Philip and Nathaniel. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathaniel and said, and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Nazareth, can anything good come from there?" Nathaniel asked. "Come and see," said Philip. When Jesus saw Nathaniel approaching, he said of him, "Here is a true Israelite, in whom there is nothing false." "How do you know me?" Nathaniel asked. Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were under the fig tree, before Philip called you." Then Nathaniel declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus said, "You believe because I told you I saw it under the fig tree. You shall see greater things than that." He then added, "I tell you the truth. You shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man."
Yes, we should definitely give a round of applause, shouldn't we? How petrified is that for most adults, let alone for grades?
And this reading is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12 to 24. "Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard in love because of their work. Live in peace with each other. And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive. Encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We're going to have Peter come and give us our word. So I thought it might be nice to pray for Peter. Ah, you preempted that. Okay, let's pray for Peter. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity that Peter has to give us a reflection upon those two wonderful readings. One thing that's been laying on my heart is about how we are responding, and I thank you for the example that you've given us, and I thank you for the words that Peter's going to speak through you. In your name, amen.
Amen. Thanks, Flo. Mrs. Smith was 99 years old, and because of the big birthday, her family had decided to give her a great big family party, to which there were lots of people invited, including the local vicar. Who was a mere stripling at 50. So where's Max? A mere stripling at 50. Anyway, the party was a great success, and at the end of it, the vicar decided to go and say thanks ever so much. So he went to Mrs. Smith, and he sort of bent down and sort of shook her hand and said, "Thank you so much for inviting Mrs. Smith. I hope that one year from today, I'll be able to join you again and celebrate your 100th birthday." To which she looked at him with a very withering look and said, "I don't see why not, young man. You look pretty healthy to me." So not quite the expected response. But then, you know, in life, things are not always as we expect. I mean, who on earth could have expected a pandemic or all the stuff that's happened? We just don't expect anything or everything. And yet, do you know what? We all have expectations of people, of situations, of life, don't we? I mean, you, I suspect, had, all of you had expectations about the service here this morning. I mean, if you've been before, you might have expected that we might have had some songs. You might have expected there might be some prayers or a Bible reading or something. You might not have expected that we'd be marching, doing sort of, you know, army sort of stuff. For Max and Adelaide's thing, I wonder what your expectations were. How would you have felt, you know, if you'd walked in and you found a bring and buy sale with coffee and donuts? Don't answer that. But you know, we all come with expectations, don't we, of stuff. And in that first reading that Grace brought to us, Philip, one of the disciples, brought his friend Nathaniel, and he got expectations about what the Messiah, who was the saviour who was promised, he'd got expectations which didn't include that the Messiah would come from Nazareth, which at the time was absolutely dirt poor, and it was little more than a few cave dwellings. And so he just didn't expect that. And yet his expectations, although they were unrealistic and wrong, were surpassed. So you will know, those of you that are regular members here, that the beginning of next month in July, we're expecting a new curate. So visitors, we're expecting a new curate who's going to come and be ordained on the 7th of July to come and work with Max. And when I was in parish ministry, when I was a parish vicar, I had four curates. And I always thought it was really important that we as a community had right expectations about what our curate is going to do and how they're going to be. Now, our new curate is called Jill, and she comes here with two children. Sadly, she was recently widowed. Her husband died very young from cancer. So she's been through life. She was a police inspector before thinking about ordination. I've known Jill quite a while because Jill credits herself with bringing my daughter and son-in-law together. Because Jill's a police inspector, Becky and Mike were both members of her team, and I don't know whether this is true, but she says, oh, she brought them together. So anyway, whatever, I'm very eternally grateful to Jill. But Jill is going to be moving here, so I'm going to talk to us just for a while this morning about us and our part in what Jill is going to be doing. So my job, if you don't know me, I'm Peter Hall, and I work for the Diocese of Portsmouth. I used to be a vicar like Max, but now I work in the diocese and I help people to try and find the place where they think God's calling them to. So if that's in some form of lay ministry, I'll help them do that. Or in Jill's case, Jill felt a real calling to be ordained. And I journeyed with Jill as she went through the national selection process, as she's been training locally, and I will be there at her ordination to sort of give her away. And I give away to somebody else, well, to Max, really. But in the service, there's a bit that sort of, that they say, the bishop will say, have they been duly called and trained? And I stand up and I say, they have. And that's a bit like at the wedding service, where somebody says, who brings this woman to marry this man? And the father of the bride says, I do. So I'm like the father of the ordinance. And I'm going to be giving Jill away at the beginning of the month. But she's going to be placed here in Bedhampton. Now, I wanted to say to you, first of all, that it's a real honour for a parish to get a curate, because they are as rare as hen's teeth. So this year, we have got three stipendiaries, paid curates. We've got other curates who are giving of their time free of charge. But we've only got three in the whole diocese of Portsmouth, and we're getting one. So that's really good, isn't it? And we choose the parishes really carefully. We only choose parishes to place curates where there's life and where there's growth and where things are going on. So that's really good. And we only place them with training comers, of which Max is going to be one, that we trust are going to encourage our curates, and that they're not going to be threatened by having somebody new and lively and enthusiastic with them. So from a diocesan point of view, the diocese thinks we're okay as a parish, and really, well, they think Max is okay to train someone. So that's a great endorsement. Because the reality is, Jill's going to be spending a lot of time with Max, and she will be having a lot of his time and his energy over the next 4 years. So, you know, we've got to be mindful of that and not be jealous in the sense that Max might be spending more time with Jill than he will with us. But, you know, it's not just down to Max. You know, Jill has been placed in a parish. I don't know if you know that saying, it takes a village to raise a child. Have you heard that? It takes a village to raise a child. Well, I want to tell you, it takes a parish to train a curate. So absolutely every single one of us who will spend time with Jill, we are a part, an important part of Jill's training, because it takes a parish to train a curate. And do you know what? As we get to know her, I think you're going to know that God has sent us somebody who's really amazing. She's got really, really lovely family in Hope and Esther. Do you know what? In the Bible, in the New Testament, right at the end, there are some letters. And some of them are written by Paul. And Paul, who was an apostle, wrote a description of Christians. And he said, Christians are like jars of clay. That's what he writes in 2 Corinthians. Christians are like jars of clay. In other words, they're ordinary, they're fallible, and they're breakable. You know, we're like jars of clay. And Jill, who I've known for many years, is a jar of clay. But, you know, Paul goes on to say, Christians are like jars of clay, they're ordinary, but you know what? They've got treasure inside them. They've got the gospel of Jesus. And I know that's absolutely true of Jill. Yeah, she's vulnerable, she's fallible, but she's got real treasures. And she's coming here to share those treasures with us. And our responsibility, folks, is to treasure Jill. To absolutely, really look after her. To help mould her. Because you know what? What she learns here, and the experience she has in Beckhampton, will set her up for probably 20 years of ministry. Max shared that he had a lovely curacy, as did I. And I had people in the parish. You know, this year, really scary, the end of the month, I would have been ordained 30 years. Where did that go? Where did those years go? But I had a wonderful curacy of people who treasured me and who looked after me. And I think we need to have realistic expectations right at the beginning of our relationship with Jill, if that's going to be a treasuring time for Jill. And I've just got a couple of things that I'd like us to bear in mind as we travel with Jill. Or maybe, you know, folks, if you come across Jill in and around the parish, you might think this as well. The first thing to remember is, really important, Jill is not perfect. Okay? Get that from the start. She is not perfect. A boy once went to a supermarket, a teen, to ask for some Persil to wash his cat. And the person in the shop said, do you know what, I don't think Persil is designed for cat washing. But the teenage boy said, no, it'll be fine. So he bought the Persil and went away. And the next week came back to the supermarket, where actually the same assistant was still around, and said, oh, how's your cat? And the boy said, oh, it's dead. And the assistant sort of had that I told you so look and said, well, do you know what? I did tell you that Persil wasn't good for cats. He said, oh, no, it wasn't the Persil. It was the spin cycle that did for it. Do you know, we all make mistakes, and perhaps not as big as that. And Jill is a jar of clay. And I want you to really remember this sentence. She will make mistakes, and she will make them on us. Hear that again? She will make mistakes on us. That's an absolute given. But you know what? The mark of a mature church is that you don't get upset. I once heard a phrase that said, custard Christians, they get upset by trifles. Have you heard that? You know, the mark of a really mature church is that we bear with people, that we love them, that we care for them, that we forgive them when they make mistakes. And Jill will absolutely do that. And we lovingly help her to grow through that. So Jill's not perfect, number one. Number two is, despite the fact that she will turn up at our church in her dog collar, looking, you know, incredibly professional, Jill is still a trainee. Point number two, Jill is still a trainee. A curacy is the second part of Jill's training. The first part is that she's done a college. That's the first. The second is that she's going to put that into practice, in a sense, on us. But she's still a trainee. And therefore, she won't be able to do things immediately, very quickly. Now, Max and I have been ordained quite a while. And we can do things quickly. Now, that's true of any job, isn't it? When you get used to it, you can do it really quickly. Jill hasn't got that yet. And she will grow into that. So she will take longer to do things. So we'll need to bear with her. She'll also be taken away from us for training opportunities. And again, we don't need to get upset at that. That's great, because we're investing in Jill. Max will be investing in Jill. The diocese investing in Jill. So that we can send her at the end of 4 years to go and be the most amazing minister somewhere else. That's the second thing. The third really important thing is that Jill is human and she has human needs. She's not some superhuman woman that's going to come in and save the parish. She is a human being and she's got human needs. Now, Jill has moved already into Warren Park, which is where the house that she's living in. But she's moved after a very, very long time from Hayling Island. Jill doesn't know anybody around here. Her children don't know anybody around here. And they're going to need Christian friends as they minister. So what I'd like to encourage us to do is to welcome her, to, you know, invite her around for coffee, get to know her, invite her for a meal. It will mean such a lot. And the other thing that we could do is we could go to the ordination. So the ordination service, it says on the bottom of our little prayer card, is that it's on the 2nd of July at 11 o'clock. You see, the added bonus of going that is you will hear me say, you'll hear me give away Jill. But the really important thing for Jill is that she will know right from the start that she's coming to a place that will love and treasure her. When I was ordained 30 years ago, there was only one person from my curacy parish who came to my ordination. And she had to be there because her son was in the cathedral choir. Nobody else came. And I was really shocked. Because I thought I was going to a lovely place, which I was. But you know, if we can come and be there at the ordination and just say to Jill, you know, she'll be surrounded by family, but just say, hi, I'm John from Bedhams, and I'm just here to support you. That will mean the absolute world to Jill and will really help her to fly. And the other thing Jill will need is she'll need balance. So I'm looking at Max now, and I know that Max will nag her to take her day off and to take all her holidays. Because she's going to need that as she's going to be with us. And the last thing is that Jill needs to receive from us in order that she can give out. I was reading an article in a Christian magazine a while ago, and it was 10 top tips to love your boss. So maybe those of you who are in employment, you might think, oh, I might be able to do this with my boss. But whether or not you do it with your boss, we really ought to be doing this sort of stuff with our curate. So I've changed it to 10 top tips to love your curate. But if you want to do it, 10 top tips to love your boss, and think in your work context, Fleur, that will be really, really helpful. The first one is, it said in this article, caffeine service. Everyone needs a coffee now and again. So that's the whole, you know, just serve people. Realise that they've got needs. The second one is pray for them. You know, whether or not you work with Christians, man, let's pray for them. If we're Christians, then we can do that for the people we work for. And clearly, Jill is a Christian, so let's pray for her. And the couple of things Jill has already asked for, she said she'd really like prayer for leaving her church. She's been at a church, St. Albans in Wesley, and they as a family have been loved there. And she knows that she's going to leave there at the end of the month. And she says she'd like us to pray for emotional strength. And that tells me that Jill is going to come here and get emotionally involved with us. She's not going to come and play at being the curate. You know, she's going to absolutely love us and be with us. And I think that's a really, really exciting thing. So let's pray for Jill. Third one is share the load. Help her. If she needs help doing something, and she will, then say yes. Celebrate achievements is the fourth one. Do you know, we get very, in clergy, we get very little feedback from people, unless it's negative, I have to say. But celebrate achievements. If Jill has done something well, and you know, the first time, like we clapped Grace, didn't we? And I hope she, you know, I hope Grace feels really encouraged, because it does take quite a bit of courage to stand up and do stuff. So if Jill's done something well, say so. Say you did that really well. If she didn't, we'll do it kindly. Okay, celebrate the good things. So the next thing is a negativity ban. Negativity can be awful. I know that from working in an office. You know, I worked in the NHS for 10 years before I was ordained. Negativity can be such a drain, can't it, if you work with people who are always negative. So have a, you know, don't grumble. And take any issues to Jill first. You know, don't go sneaking off to Max or anybody else. Talk it out with Jill. The next one, it said in the thing, it said hug your boss. And I'm thinking, oh golly, I can remember my boss in the NHS, and you know, that would have been, you know, the end of my career, really. But you might want to give Jill a hug. Jill's a very huggy woman, so but think very carefully about if you're gonna do this at work. Be appropriate. The next thing it said in the article was face-to-face. Communicate face-to-face. If there are issues, do it face-to-face. Don't send an email. Do you know, I sent an email this week, and it wasn't a nasty email, but I pushed reply all instead of the just to the person, and I then had to go through and just check what I'd said, and I was fine. But, you know, do face-to-face stuff. The next thing it said was keep a truth belt. Make sure that however you work with your boss or with Jill, do it in love and do it in truth. And the last two are relate yourself. It says put yourself in the curer's or the boss's shoes. Joe, it's easy to point the finger, isn't it? But what would we do if we were in their shoes? And then finally it says be an initiative taker. Come and say, I've got this idea, Jill. What do you think? What can you help me with? Because that would be really, really good. So just bringing things to a close. We need to have right expectations of Jill before she arrives. And I think we have, because from a diocesan point of view, we wouldn't have placed Jill here if we didn't think we were really good people. And as a member of the congregation, I would count myself in that. So let's get our expectations right. In our Bible reading, Nathanael's expectations of Jesus were just wrong. He said, oh, Nazareth, that terrible place. Can anything good come from there? But he had his expectations turned on their heads. Now, in any relationship, or actually any adventure, any good relationship, any good adventure, there's risk involved, isn't there? So for Nathanael, he took a risk. Philip said, look, come and see. Three really important words, come and see. And Nathanael came and saw. His mind was just blown away. We are taking a risk having Jill. But you know what? She's taking a bigger risk coming here and working with Max and with us. It is risk-filled. But, you know, Jill has heard the call and she's heard God say, come and see. Come and see these people at St. Thomas's and St. Nick's. They're going to help grow you as a minister. And I believe we've heard that call to come and see about Jill as well. And I hope that we are going to have amazing time together. The end of our reading said this. Jesus said to Nathanael, you believe because I told you I saw you under the fig tree. But you will see greater things than that. You will see greater things than that. And I tell you the truth, you'll see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. Now, I do not know if we are going to see heaven open and we're going to see angels descending on Jill. But God knows. You know, and we are in really, really safe hands. Because the Lord is absolutely in this. I don't know what the next 4 years are going to be like, but God knows. But I do know this, it will be exciting and it will be unpredictable. And that's really, really good. And I think if we bear all these things in mind as we welcome Jill at the end of the month and as we travel with her through the next 4 years, I think that we're going to have a wonderful time with Jill and her daughters, and she's going to have a wonderful time with us. So why don't we just take a moment just to pause and to hold Jill and Hope and Esther just in our minds as we pray for them. Lord God, we thank you so much that women and men are hearing your call to follow you, to come and see what you're doing. We thank you for Jill, for her faith in you. Thank you, Lord, for her faith in Max and in us, that she's coming to a place that will treasure and nurture her. Help us, Father, to have right and good expectations as we welcome them and we journey with them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Peter. I just wanted to kind of reflect on what Peter was saying about our expectations of God, and perhaps we limit our expectations of God, and we put God in a box, that box is okay. Especially in church, I think we do this. That's okay for God to be in that box and to be on that Sunday in this time. And I wonder, actually, is that also a challenge for us to have right expectations for Jill, but also to have right expectations of ourselves and our own faith, of what God will do in our lives? God is far, far bigger than we can ever imagine. You know, I love the idea of omnipotence. You know, he knows everything. And that's a wonderful, reassuring thing. And I'm kind of reminded of what Max says. You know, that's not to be panicked or stressed about. God is a total open door. And he invites us back into him every single day. One thing that I do want to challenge us with that invitation, let's not make that door tiny. You know, that make that door massive. And I want to be like Nathaniel. You know, I want to see heaven on earth. And I know I can because God's promised me that. And so I share Peter's excitement for the next 4 years. And I, in a poker type way, raise him. And I say, let's not be expectation just of Jill, but let's have that expectation for ourselves as well, you know, to see God moving in our lives over the next 4 years. And let's make this a cornerstone and mark that, because we have been so blessed beyond our wildest dreams. Because I think of some churches that I've been involved in, and the idea that you would get a curate as well as like an established vicar, and obviously we've got so many ordained people in our congregation. So we're very thankful, and with a heart of thankfulness, we're going to come to our prayers. Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious Lord, you are the mystery of three in one, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You are the God of justice and peace. We have made your world a place of confusion and discord. Guide us all to change our ways, to make your world a community of justice and love. Open our eyes, Lord, to the glory of your creation. We open our hearts to receive your love, expressed in the diversity of the world you have created for us to inhabit. Show us how to care for your gift of this beautiful planet. Draw our worldwide church together, O Lord, into one great company of disciples, together following the example of our Lord Jesus Christ in every part of our lives, serving him in his mission to the world by witnessing to his love, Encourage us by your word to grow in faith and approach the door you have opened for us to enter. We pray for the unity of Christian communities throughout your world. Bless the ministry of Max and Susie in this parish and support us as we embrace your vision, identity and purpose for this church. We look forward to the arrival of Jill in the next step of her ministry as our curate. Please prepare us to welcome Jill to our church and give her our encouragement and support. We welcome Adelaide and Max to our church family this morning. Please bestow your grace and love upon Adelaide, Max, and their parents, godparents, and families. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, you are the way of peace. Enter the brokenness of this world with your love. We pray for people throughout your world in positions of public trust, that they will use their authority wisely to promote justice and the dignity and freedom of all people who depend upon their integrity. Alleviate the plight of the poor, especially those facing the prospect of famine as a consequence of conflict. Give hope to all people living as refugees, displaced by conflict, climate change, and poverty. Bring compassion and dignity to their lives through the work of the United Nations and aid agencies. Heavenly Father, we pray for peace throughout your world, the peace of your will, our need. Kindle, we pray, in the hearts of all people, the true love of peace and unity. Protect the people of Ukraine from further harm. In your infinite wisdom, please intervene in this conflict and open the route to a ceasefire. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. Grant us a vision, Lord, for the community in which we live, to enable us to understand what can be accomplished. Encourage us to share our faith and lives with our neighbours and to be aware when help is needed. Assure us of the working of the Holy Spirit within us as we speak to friends and neighbours. Help us, as we have the opportunity, to make our own contribution to this community and to be good neighbours, that by love we will serve one another. We pray for the residents of Kingscroft Lane in this parish. Walk beside them in their everyday lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. We pray for people known to us in this church who are unwell or have requested our prayers. We pray by name for Peter, Bonnie, Eileen, Janice, Amelia, Michael, Marjorie, Anne, Valerie and Eric, Claire, Richard and Ian. Surround them with your light, enfold them in your presence, and heal them with your power. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring before you, Lord, people whose earthly life has come to an end. Give them the peace that comes from your victory over death, and give comfort to the families and friends who grieve the loss of their loved ones. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Church where we all welcome one another and we share the peace. So I'm going to say the words in white and we're all going to say the words in yellow. Christ is our peace. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, everything has become new. The grace
of our Lord Jesus Christ,
and the love of God,
and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all, evermore.
Amen.
Amen.
You can have a song.
I need children.
Oh. Mike's going, looking, running.
Can I just, while waiting for the children to come back, just to say, we will go into the ordination on the 2nd of July. Park is interested down in Old Portsmouth, isn't it? So what we'll do is we'll put a notice in the sheet this week to say that, you know, if you want a car, then come and share it, and you can do that. So we'll make sure that happens this week. And Peter also alluded earlier on that I had the most wonderful curacy. And that was because the people loved me. Not because of who I am, it's because they were loving people. And so I just want to encourage you, as Peter has done, that's really important. And also, I had the best training incumbent in the world, who'd had a few curates in his time and knew how to look after them. And so I'm going to need that wisdom. So I would also appreciate your prayer that I would have wisdom in how I lead her over the next few years.
Those of you who have sampled the joys of the temporary facilities in the courtyard, I need to tell you two amazing bits of information, which is that the current refurbishment, rebuilding, or whatever you want to call it, on the existing toilets is on budget and on time.
Hey.
That is amazing, isn't it? A period of extraordinary inflation.
Hold it, you have to hold it up so people can see up that way. So if you let go and come in the way, Grace, you hold this corner and you have to hold that corner.
There we go.
What does it say? Oh, you need to come in front of this lectern, because they can't see it. I'm sorry about the paint, parents. I really am sorry. I tried. I did. Anyway. What is it? What does it say, Elliot?
Love is a fruit of the spirit.
It's a fruit of the spirit. And is love all squishy, lovey-dovey, huggy? No. Do our mums and dads love us even when they tell us off? Yeah, we're sure about that. Love is an action, isn't it? Love is an action. Mums and dads do lots of things for us, don't they? Because they love us. We need to be kind to people. Don't read the right
names.
Yeah, they have all their names
on here. Oh, it's beautiful.
If you could lie it down there on the floor, and then we can go sit down.
Oh, well done.
To see.
The Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, teach you to walk in his way more trustfully, to accept his truth more faithfully, and to share his life more lovingly, that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may come as one family to the kingdom of the Father. And the blessing of God Almighty,
the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit
be amongst us and remain